now my pleasure to introduce this evening's speaker. Dr. Pervé Hootboy is a professor of physics at Caid Al-Azam University in Islamabad, where he has taught for 32 years. Dr. Hootboy received his PhD in nuclear physics from MIT and has been a visiting professor at MIT, Carnegie Mellon University, the University of Maryland, and the Stanford Linear Accelerator. Dr. Hootboy has been recognized by prizes in mathematics and in electronics. He is also the recipient of the Faiz Aham Faiz Prize for contributions to education in Pakistan and the UNESCO Kalinga Prize for the popularization of science, and I think you'll discover why when you hear him speak in a few moments. Dr. Hootboy is the author of the book Islam and Science, Religious Orthodoxy and the Battle for Rationality, and he is also an activist in social issues of nuclear disarmament, women's rights, education, and importantly, the environment. He's a sponsor of the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists and frequently comments on nuclear and political issues in Pakistan to the international media. Please join me in listening to the insightful comments and welcoming Dr. Hootboy, who is speaking on U.S. nuclear non-proliferation policy, India, Pakistan, and beyond. Welcome.
Thank you for this kind introduction. Thank you, Cecilia, and thank you, Professor Margolis, for making my visit over here possible. So I thought that I would begin by just going way back into the past, a year after the formation of Pakistan and India, the partition which occurred in 1947. That was a time when you could not have imagined that either country would ever have the bomb. But in 1948, the Indian Atomic Energy Agency was formed, and it was primarily done at the initiative of Dr. Homi Bhabha, who was an excellent physicist, had done remarkable work in quantum field theory while at the University of Cambridge, had returned and inspired the Prime Minister of India, Jawaharlal Nehru. Remember that this was a time when nuclear energy had made its debut. There was Hiroshima, of course, and then there was the promise of nuclear power. This was to be an age where electricity would be produced so cheap that you wouldn't need power meters. So Nehru was convinced by Bhabha that there should be an atomic energy agency and India should move along this path. However, the aims of the agency were kept deliberately ambiguous. 1955, Bertrand Russell visited India and he met with both Jawaharlal Nehru and Homi Bhabha, and he liked Jawaharlal Nehru a lot, found himself on the same wavelength, both believing in secular values, both believing in science and rationality and so forth. But he didn't like Bhabha very much, because when he tried to speak to Bhabha about the need for keeping the program peaceful, he got blank stares. He hit a stone wall. And so when he left, he was unable to convince Nehru into saying anything definitive. And so the plans were already latent in 1948. Now you might ask why. There was no threat to India at that time. There was no Chinese problem. In fact, the slogan in those days used to be Chini Hindi Bhai Bhai, meaning Chinese and Indians are brothers. Well, that broke down in 1962, and that was the Chinese-Indian border war. And 1962 was when India started getting serious about making the bomb. And so the program, which had been ambiguous up to this point, was then turned around. And yes, there was nuclear power development, but then there was also the bomb, which was seriously pursued. And 1974 was when India tested its so-called peaceful nuclear device. At that time, well, the idea that you could have peaceful nuclear devices had pretty much disappeared, but nevertheless, there was this fiction that you could have such a thing, and various excuses that, hey, you can dig trenches with this, and you can build dams and move earth, and I don't know what. But anyway, that 1974 explosion never produced a single consequence which had any economic utility for India. That nuclear test was the driving force for Pakistan's nuclear program. And yes, although there had been a meeting of Pakistani scientists who had been called together by Prime Minister Zulfiqar Ali Bhutto in 1972 in the city of Multan, where Bhutto had expressly asked them, can you make the bomb? And how long will it take you to make the bomb? And he did this because a year earlier, one half of Pakistan had broken off. There had been a civil war, that which led to the emergence of Bangladesh, tens of thousands of people killed, millions of refugees and so forth, one of those awful, horrible episodes. And Pakistan had come out half of what it had been at the time of partition. Naturally very bitter, naturally wanting revenge, wanting security, whatever. That was the motive that started Pakistan's acquisition or attempt to acquire nuclear weapons. Well, that meeting did occur, but it was 2 years later, after the Indian nuclear test, that the program seriously began. Now, at that time, the aims were rather clear. It was Pakistani nukes for Indian nukes, bomb for bomb. Over time, that metamorphosed. It changed into something else. I'll come to that later. But when you, well, let me move on to 1977. 1977, the initiator of the nuclear program, Zulfiqar Ali Bhutto, is put into jail and subsequently hanged by General Ziaul Haq, who overthrows him. Bhutto had become unpopular. And from his prison cell, he wrote his memoirs saying that if I am actually hanged, and he was, the reason will be that I initiated the nuclear program for Pakistan, and it is the Americans who he felt were behind his hanging. That was, I believe, a delusion, but we can argue about that if somebody feels to the contrary. And he made this famous assertion that every civilization has a bomb. The Christians have theirs, the Jews have theirs, and the Hindus have theirs, and now it's up to us, the Muslims, to have this bomb. And that's the first time in history that the word Islamic bomb had ever been used. I say this because I'm going to be referring to this issue later on of whether there is such a thing or could be such a thing as an Islamic bomb. And so I consider 1977 as a landmark point in that respect. Well, then things move on. Now, Pakistan got the bomb from a direction that was different from the one it had been aiming initially. It sought to get nuclear materials the way that India had got its, which was through the reprocessing of reactor waste. And so, given that Pakistan had a small nuclear reactor, 137 megawatts electrical, from Canada, it's what is called the Canadian Natural Deuterium Uranium Reactor, CANDU. So it wanted to use that CANDU fuel and reprocess that, and for that reason it ordered a reprocessing plant from France And France was willing to sell it to Pakistan, but then the Americans leaned upon France and that deal was cancelled. But it so turned out that there was a Pakistani who was working in Holland. His name is now a legend. I scarcely need to tell you who he was, Dr. A.Q. Khan, Abdul Qadir Khan. And he was working with these ultra centrifuges, which spin uranium hexafluoride gas around very, very rapidly. So they're like glorified washing machines, you might say, but they, instead of turning around 30 times a second, they turn around 10,000 times a second. And so they generate enormous centrifugal forces. And there's this very special technology that's needed to handle those kinds of stresses and vibrations and so forth. So he was working in Holland, and he very industriously copied all the designs and brought them to Pakistan, said and sold the idea to Bhutto, and so a second route started. This route was successful, and in 1986 Pakistan actually acquired a bomb that was we don't know whether it was deliverable or not, but it was very close to the final one. And so that's the next landmark over there. 87 was when perhaps the first, contact between A.Q. Khan and the Iranians. And perhaps the first time when transfer of information, which was subsequently transformed into the transfer of centrifuges, was started. So by 87, 88, Pakistan definitely had deliverable bombs, and some say 87, and one indication of that is that in 87, there was a crisis which was prompted by events in Kashmir, and which I refer to as nuclear crisis number one. Things had gotten a bit hot in Kashmir. As many of you know, this is a piece of territory that's disputed between India and Pakistan. In 87, there was an insurgency that grew from strength to strength, mostly caused because India had, or rather the ruling government in Delhi had rigged the elections in Kashmir and generated a lot of anger among the domestic population. But India ascribed that as Pakistan's meddling in Kashmir, and so there was a state of great tension, and Indian troops and tanks were moved from inland towards the Pakistani border. This generated a lot of concern and then fear in Pakistan, and then it is said that Pakistan sent a signal across that, hey, we have nukes, and this threat was conveyed through the Americans. The Indians backed off after that, and several people in Pakistan are convinced, none of the Indians I've ever talked to are convinced or would or think that it is true, but nevertheless, many in Pakistan believe that this was the first time that our nukes saved us. And then there was a repeat of this in 1990. This was again a time when things had gotten very hot in Kashmir, and at this point, again, Indian divisions were rolling towards Pakistan with the view of sending a message across. You might call it intimidation. And at that time, it is said that American satellites picked up images of nuclear weapons departing from Kahuta, which is the main uranium enrichment facility and bomb-making facility in Pakistan. It's about 40 miles from the university that I teach at, and these bombs were making their way to the airport, Chaflala Airport, where F-16s were stationed on the tarmac and that they were being loaded on, that these satellites caught this picture and this information was then transmitted again via the Americans to the Indians and they backed off. So that's nuclear crisis number two. I'm talking about these nuclear crises because today, both India and Pakistan are giving a very different image to the world, that of being responsible nuclear powers who are stable, who know what they have and know how to deal with them. So it's important that we look at history before we accept this point of view. So that was nuclear crisis number two. And then, on the 11th of May, 1998, India shocks the world out of its mind. That was with the nuclear tests. Five nuclear tests, all on the same day, announced proudly by India. And at that point, it shed any pretensions that these were for peaceful purposes. Now they were out in the open. And as it tested, it gloated and it challenged Pakistan and said, "Do you know that this is now a different subcontinent?" And in fact, the precise words of the vice president of the BJP was that the balance of power on the subcontinent has shifted, and now Pakistan had better realize that. Coupled with that, there was intensified shelling across the line of control, and all this generated an enormous fear in Pakistan. And although there were voices which said, and I might say including mine, that we should not test in spite of the provocation, that ultimately it is better that we wait it out, yet there was no chance. And 17 days later, Pakistan tested. There was wild jubilation on the streets of Islamabad, of Rawalpindi, of Lahore, Pakistani cities, just like 17 days earlier, people had come out whooping with joy in the streets of Delhi. And this was to be the period of great peace and the end of war on the subcontinent. Nuclear hawks on both sides had said, "We need to test our weapons," and they had said this for years and years earlier, because once these weapons are out of the closet, now everyone knew that something was going on, but nobody knew how much, and people had doubts whether these weapons existed or not and how many there were and so forth. But now there were no doubts anymore, and they had been advocating, the nuclear hawks had been advocating, that we must bring them out in the open, because once we've established that we have these nukes, then there cannot be war anymore, because they are such a terrible deterrent. Why would you need tanks? Why would you need aircraft? Why would you need submarines and so forth when just one of these is enough to annihilate a city? A very seductive argument, but one could see, looking at the history of the US-Soviet race, that this was bunk. And so it proved to be. In the first year after the Indian tests, the Indian defense budget went up by 28%. And Pakistan, which would have wanted to match it by 11%, but it was now on the verge of economic collapse, because just as it tested, sanctions were imposed against it, the economy started folding in. But anyway, all this might have been justified if subsequently there had been peace. But what actually happened was very much to the contrary. In March of 1999, I should say earlier, February of 1999, Pakistan, which felt so emboldened by the presence of nuclear weapons, launched a secret invasion in the mountainous area of Kargil, that is in Kashmir, or rather in that part of Kashmir which lies on the line of control. And this incursion was attributed to Mujahideen, which Pakistan claimed it had no control over. But in fact, it was some Mujahideen, but mostly Pakistan Army soldiers. Pakistan knew that India would want to retaliate, but that it would not be able to because it was now behind the nuclear shield. Normally, nuclear weapons are supposed to deter war. But here, they actually caused war. I don't think there's another example in history that you can find where nuclear weapons actually caused a war to happen. And that's what occurred. The incursion lasted for several months. It became bloodier and bloodier. India then responded first with artillery attacks, then with airstrikes, and now it was clear that things were going to move to a different level. The Pakistan government, which had hitherto been denying that it was in any way involved, then started getting cold feet. And so on the 4th of July 1999, the Prime Minister of Pakistan flew to Washington and met with Bill Clinton and said, "Yeah, we're ready for a ceasefire." And that was the end, or the beginning of the end of his government. It was followed subsequently by a coup. General Musharraf takes over. Pakistan gets a bloody nose. It gets a bad name. It's clearly responsible, and a political as well as military disaster. So, that was nuclear crisis number three, to be followed by number four, which followed the attack on the Indian Parliament on the 13th of December 2001. A million soldiers subsequently faced each other, eyeball to eyeball. Nuclear threats were hurled in both directions. You had the chief of Indian Army staff, the head of the Indian Army, saying, "We will make radioactive cinders out of Pakistan. They better watch what they're doing." And you had the Indian Defense Minister saying, "They won't know what hit them. We will annihilate them. We will wipe them off from the face of the earth." And here we had the great General Pervez Musharraf saying, "I have unconventional means of dealing with them." Meaning nukes. So as we listen to Pakistani and Indian leaders today, let's recall these facts of history, and let's not allow ourselves to be swayed by the sweetness of their words today. Today they project the image of responsibility, of unflappability, of being perfectly in control of their, what they call their nuclear assets. But the truth may actually be very far from that. Well, things might have continued in this way, but for two things. One was 9/11, and the other was the admission by A.Q. Khan that he was involved in this racket of spreading nuclear weapons, or technology for nuclear weapons, to Libya, to Iran, and to North Korea. And now, because of both 9/11, and 9/11 impacted upon Pakistan much more than it did on India, because it resulted in the breaking of the close ties between the Pakistani military and the Taliban, as well as the other jihadist forces that have been operating with the permission and with the assistance and encouragement of the Pakistani military. What happened subsequently was that Pakistan had to take a U-turn. It was faced with the choice that either it was with the jihadis or it joined up with the US in fighting them. And so it chose to leave its former allies, who then felt deeply upset, and they turned the direction of their guns around. So today what you have is General Musharraf, having twice successfully escaped assassination, nevertheless living in fear of the very forces that he had helped set in motion. These are the ironies of history, and I don't think we learn sufficiently from them. As the human race, I'd say. This is the mistake that was made by Prime Minister Indira Gandhi when she encouraged Sikh separatists, who eventually turned around and assassinated her. This is the mistake that was made by the Americans when they organized the great international jihad with the help of Pakistan and Saudi Arabia to defeat the Soviet Union. What we see in every case is blowback, and that continues to this day. Pakistan and India both had nuclear sanctions slapped upon them by the United States. But then, with this turnaround and with the thawing of relations, as we saw earlier this year, India is to get a special nuclear deal. But now let me move on to the role of the United States in South Asia. So let me come very specifically to the topic that I am to discuss. In earlier years, there had been a massive program called Atoms for Peace. And the belief in those times was that nuclear energy would be the solution to the world's energy problem, and that it would bring electricity so cheap, you didn't have to meter it. All you had to do was to dig uranium out of the ground, and you would have fuel for free, don't have to worry about oil, everything's dandy. Well, later on, that entire perspective changed, as we know. But it was that initial idea, that initial program called Atoms for Peace, which resulted in nuclear technology reaching the Indian subcontinent in the form of reactors. And these were principally of the CANDU type. CANDU type take natural uranium as their fuel, and then the spent fuel that comes out contains plutonium, which can be reprocessed, extracted from it, and converted into bomb-grade material. This is the route that India had followed. India had received heavy water, and India had received highly enriched uranium for its Tarapur reactor. And Pakistan had received a nuclear reactor as a small research reactor located at Pinstek near Islamabad, and you can almost see it from where I am, the university that was given by the Americans, together with the fuel for it. But these were the initial days, the heady days of nuclear power. But after the nuclear tests by India in 1974, voices in Congress started demanding that there be bans, that there be sanctions put upon those countries which were acquiring nuclear technology outside of the NPT. And so the first legal instrument that was used was an amendment to the Foreign Assistance Act. So FAA over here stands for Foreign Assistance Act. And the first amendment was by Senator Symington, followed by Senator Glenn. Now the Glenn and the Symington amendments are very similar to each other. They call for stopping all assistance in nuclear matters, in every matter, I'm sorry, to those countries which are trying to acquire nuclear weapons. And then there was the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Act, which said that any country that was acting outside of the NPT and which the IAEA would not certify as strictly peaceful would be subject to sanctions. And so there was this whole there's this whole bunch of legal instruments that were created for dealing with India and Pakistan, except that they weren't implemented. And they weren't implemented in the case of Pakistan for a very good reason. That is because in the Soviet, after the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan, the US found Pakistan as indispensable for raising that jihad army which would fight against the Soviets. In 1979, Jimmy Carter had imposed sanctions upon Pakistan, and now the United States needed Pakistan as an ally in that war. The Pressler Amendment, which you see was 1985, specifically banned any kind of aid for a country which was even trying to acquire nuclear weapons. And it required specifically that the President of the United States certify that a country which is to receive US assistance is not engaged in the process of trying to make nuclear weapons. And so what you had was this interesting spectacle where President Ronald Reagan would sign year after year that Pakistan was not trying to make nuclear weapons and did not possess a nuclear device. On the other hand, and of course, in this he was advised by the CIA. The CIA would present its report to the president, and the president would then duly certify, and that would then go to Congress, and then aid would be released. This was that time where if you had stopped a cab in Rawalpindi or Islamabad and asked to be taken to the bomb factory, the cab driver would have known exactly where to go. In fact, if you stood at one of the bus stops over there, you would have these conductors of the buses leaning out and saying, "Bomb factory, bomb factory, who's for the bomb factory?" And yet, it was, I suppose, the CIA's information, intelligence, which made it report religiously to the president that no, Pakistan is not seeking to make nuclear weapons. And therefore, this continued. It continued until 1990, when suddenly the US discovered that, hey, they have bombs. And so Pressler was imposed, and that was the end of that. The Pressler Amendment stayed on until the nuclear tests and beyond. But after 9/11, it all changed. Well, I should have said that in 2001, some sanctions were waived on India. Many of them were waived on India, but just a few for Pakistan. That was the one that was waived, I believe, was because of pressure from farmers in the Midwest, because they wanted to sell wheat to Pakistan, and they had so they got some change made through Senator Brownback. So let me ask myself a few key questions. We saw that in the four nuclear crises, and I must say that not all people agree that there are four. They want to perhaps deny that actually there were any at all. But certainly in 1999 and 2001, you had massive army presence across the borders. And you had fiery rhetoric on both sides, and yet you did not have war. So did nuclear deterrence work at that time? And I think my personal opinion is that it did. Sure, India, after Kargil, was in a mood angry enough that if Pakistan did not have nukes, it would have walked in. And it would have given the Pakistan army a terribly hard time, perhaps destroyed it. And so I believe, not all my friends agree with me on this, but nuclear deterrence does work. But the real question is, will it work forever? It worked four times. Maybe it'll work another four times. Well, will it work the ninth time? Or will it work the 27th time? There's no theorem, you know, that it'll keep on working. Moreover, there's another issue which I think is, at least to me, very disturbing, which is that in the crisis of 2002, you have these million soldiers facing each other, threats being hurled, and yet the population is quite indifferent. The schools didn't close, the colleges were open, nobody was stocking up on food, the stock market was where it was, and nobody was taking money out from the banks and so forth, and nobody was scared. And now that is scary, that people are not scared. Because what is deterrence about? Deterrence is predicated upon fear. And if people lose the fear of nuclear weapons, then will deterrence actually continue to work? Therefore, I feel that, well, yes, four times it worked, but it won't work forever. Wherever there is a finite probability, if you test it, if you repeat and repeat and repeat, eventually the probability of failure is going to be one. It's going to be certain. And therefore, to my mind, there are excellent reasons why we should not believe that the present situation is stable. Moreover, it's not stable for another reason, because there is a high influx of weapons into the area. Recently, the United States has agreed to sell 40 F-16 fighters, which are capable of delivering nuclear weapons, to Pakistan. And it is going to sell, or at least has offered to sell, F-16s as well as the more advanced F-18s to India. There are also anti-ballistic missile systems which are now being contemplated by India. Their acquisition is being contemplated. Should that happen, that would induce another element of destabilization. And then there are arms salesmen from all over the world which are converging onto these two countries and selling them Falcon early warning systems, Green Pine radars, phased array radars and so forth. Over the next 7 years, India is planning to buy $100 billion worth of new weaponry. That's just simply mind-blowing. If you consider the level of poverty, the way people live in India as well as Pakistan, to spend these huge amounts is criminal. Well, let me come now to the issue of the US-India nuclear deal. That's been talked about somewhat in the press over here, I see. But that's been far from sufficient. The argument given by the Bush administration is that we cannot now turn India around. They will keep their nukes. And so, recognizing its importance, why don't we enter into a nuclear deal with them, which would allow them access to US nuclear technology, which would principally mean reactors as well as the fuel for reactors. For India, this is a particularly attractive idea because India has very little uranium resources. In fact, if it was to mine all the resources that it has presently, that would not be sufficient to run its reactors at the current rate for more than a few years. Since it seeks an expansion of its nuclear power program, it has to seek uranium supplies from outside. And therefore, it is very keen to get uranium fuel from countries outside, but none will sell to it because of the sanctions on nuclear materials. Both India, or I should say, both the nuclear lobby in India, as well as the Bush administration, are therefore convinced that this is to their mutual benefit. But I think we need to ponder upon its implications. If this nuclear deal goes through, then it will allow India to divert uranium that it would otherwise consume in its power plants into the production of nuclear warheads. Furthermore, it would allow India to complete its program of building breeder reactors. Now, these breeder reactors, they produce plutonium in vast quantities. And once this program is completed, India would have the capacity to produce between 30 to 50 fission warheads within a period of 1 year, which would be almost as many as it has been able to produce in the last 25 or 30 years. So it would represent a quantum increase in India's ability to make nuclear weapons. And what does Pakistan do? Well, already there are voices calling out for duplicating Kahuta. Kahuta is the uranium enrichment plant over there. And so the ex-foreign minister has recently written an article saying that it's time that we make not just one, but we make two or perhaps more Kahutas and spread them around the country. That's where Pakistan's efforts might go. But they would also go in a different way, because with the Indian nuclear arsenal increasing in size, well, then you have to have more missiles in a higher state of alert, dispersed around more. And then this increases the possibility of accidental use, of their being hijacked, of all sorts of things that could subsequently happen. Interestingly, the United States has made a demand upon India, which India has rejected, and that demand was that there should be no nuclear tests, no new nuclear tests. India says this is an infringement upon our national sovereignty and that this deal should go ahead in spite of our reserving our right to have or not have nuclear tests. Of course, since the United States has rejected the CTBT, there is no obligation upon either India or Pakistan to sign it anymore. And this, I think, is a real tragedy, because in the year 2000, at the beginning of the year 2000, I'd say Pakistan and India were pretty much 50% of the way towards signing the CTBT. Yes, in earlier years, there had been a very angry reaction. Oh, the Americans, the French, the Russians, they have tested thousands of times. And that's literally true, thousands of times. How dare they tell us not to test? But with a combination, with pressure brought upon by the Clinton administration upon Pakistan as well as India, The two countries were inching towards that. And I'll give you my reason for my thinking that, because the foreign minister of Pakistan called me up and he said, can you come to a meeting that we're having tomorrow for the Foreign Policy Advisory Group and speak to them about the CTBT? And I said, are you sure that you want me to come? You know where I stand. I'm deadly against nuclear weapons as well as their testing, of course. He says, look, I'm not telling you what to say, but you come. You come and speak over there. And I did, and made the case that having nuclear testing for Pakistan was bad. It would not gain anything. Besides, you don't need to test because you have fission weapons, you can computer simulate, etc., etc., all the technical reasons. And they clapped. All right? So that's my reason for believing that indeed we were getting close. But then it all went out of the window because Congress refused to ratify it. Finished. And nobody's talking about CTBT. Nobody's talking about the Fissile Material Cutoff Treaty also, which to my mind is really at the core of nuclear proliferation. Time and time again, this question is raised. How safe are Pakistan's weapons? And the government comes out saying, oh, they're perfectly safe. Yes, but what does that mean? We don't know. But certainly after 9/11, there was a great feeling of worry within the government that they could be hijacked, they could be bombed by the Americans, and so they were all taken to different secret locations. And I am told on good authority that some of them were taken to one of the northern parts of Pakistan, a city called Gilgit, which is impossible to fly into except navigating between mountains and with your wings touching one or the other, nearly touching one or the other, and that's where some of the nuclear weapons were kept. So there is a great deal of insecurity that is felt within the military itself. So whatever they might say, there is in fact something that they're not telling us. After AQ Khan, I'd say that the answer to this question is no at the official level. Pakistan's government will not allow its nuclear bomb makers to proliferate. But then what happens at lower levels? What happens with entrepreneurs in this business? That I think is an open question. Now let me come to other issues, things that bother people's minds. And one of these is the question of the Islamic bomb. As I had mentioned that in 1977, this was the first time that this word was used. After 1998 and the sanctions upon Pakistan, this was used much more often. In fact, in the demonstrations that, in the jubilations that followed the nuclear tests, you had the religious extremist parties of Pakistan carry cardboard replicas of the missiles with nuclear tip up front with Islamic bomb written upon that. I interviewed a number of religious political leaders and found that they believed that Pakistan's bomb was for more than just defending its borders. In fact, I made a video documentary film which I could not show yesterday. I showed the one on Kashmir, but this is this is also a documentary that I had made. This was made subsequent to 9/11, just before 9/11, I'm sorry. And it contains interviews which show attitudes on this. Nevertheless, I do not think that as yet there is any such thing as an Islamic bomb. The Pakistani bomb is one that was initially specifically to counter Indian nukes. Later on, its purposes metamorphosed, became wider. For one, it was to counter India's increasing military strength in the conventional field. And it was only after the rising Islamism in Pakistan that people started talking about the need to defend other Muslims around the world. But that's, I think, still a minority view in Pakistan. What might happen in the future, I don't know. So now let me come back specifically on the issue of the United States and nuclear proliferation. There has been a significant change in US attitudes towards nuclear weapons, and this is contained in the Nuclear Posture Review, which was leaked to the press at the beginning of 2002, and it is, I think, a landmark change, because for the first time nuclear weapons are being seen not as weapons of last resort, but as means by which you fight wars. And so this Nuclear Posture Review says that the US must gear its nuclear program so that when necessary, it uses those nuclear weapons, maybe against a state which has nuclear weapons, but maybe against one which does not. And so in fact, you see a reflection of that when people these days are talking about how to take out India, how to take out Iran's nuclear program, and this talk of whether you should use smart bombs and whether smart bombs will do the job, or whether in fact you should use bunker busters. This is a discussion that has not escaped the attention of the rest of the world. I don't know the extent to which this has appeared in the US press, but the Nuclear Posture Review, with this implicit, or rather I should say, with this explicit threat that the US can use nuclear weapons even against non-nuclear countries, this is a message that has not been lost. This is why North Korea will simply not give up its program. They saw what happened to Iraq, and the message that countries around the world have taken. They said, hey, Iraq was attacked because it supposedly had weapons of mass destruction, but in fact it was attacked because it did not have weapons of mass destruction and did not have nukes. So if you want to be safe from an American attack, get nukes. And this is the message that the Iranians have taken. The Nuclear Posture Review also says that we must go in for new and smaller nuclear weapons, not the big mega city busters, not the fusion bombs, but you know, little things that you can just throw a couple of kilotons worth of destruction. Also these things which burrow deep under the ground, perhaps also fissionless fusion bombs, which would not release this huge amount of radioactivity. And that kind of thinking now scares people. It terrifies people around the world. That is the kind of fear that then promotes proliferation. You feel you're safe only if you have nukes. What's happening today is that the NPT is slowly dying. It's dying not just because of North Korea, not just because of Iran, but also because its fundamental tenets are being violated. The NPT says that nuclear weapon states should gradually give up their nuclear weapons. And this is Article 6 of the NPT. In fact, what we see is the very reversal of that. What we see is that new kinds of nuclear weapons are being produced, and furthermore, their doctrines of use are being reassessed. And so therefore, I think the NPT is in serious danger. Maybe it's an anachronistic document, but nobody can think of a way of doing something better than that. However, its death, I think, will be truly a tragedy, because after that, you have no international legal instrument which prohibits the spreading of nuclear weapons. Bad as it is, I believe it should continue to survive. So then what is it that is going to stop us from some group getting this together? And I say that the only way you can prevent this is through controlling fissile material production and controlling and keeping tabs upon the fissile material that's already been produced. Whether that's been produced in bombs or whether it's the stuff that has come off from the Soviet disassembled bombs in the ex-Soviet Union countries. That is where the key lies. If you have highly enriched uranium and it gets into the hands of people who want to set off an explosion, want to make a nuclear device, they can do it. Therefore, in my opinion, what we need is a revival of discussion of the Fissile Material Cutoff Treaty, and we have to have international monitoring and international production of fissile materials, as was proposed by Al-Baradei of the International Atomic Energy Agency, that all fissile materials should be under the control of a central body, the IAEA, and that its production, its use and disposal be monitored. And here, of course, it would be the participation of the international community, Americans, Russians, French, Indians, whatever. Without that, I'm afraid that in years to come, we're going to end up with phenomenal amounts of fissile materials over which we will have no control, no knowledge, and whose consequences we cannot foresee at this present time. So I'm sorry for having taken more than my required time, and I look forward to your interactions, to your criticisms as well. I'm sure there are some things that I may have said which you do not agree with, but in any case, I'll stop you. Thank you.